Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the AEPi Shabbat D'var series. My name is Brother Zachary Kirshner from the Delta Gamma chapter at Grand Valley State University. I want to thank all of our friends and brothers who are joining us today from across the world. As we close off the week and welcome the Sabbath, we are thrilled to have a special guest for you all and someone who holds a very special place in my heart. My uncle, David Seth Kirshner of Closter, New Jersey, is the senior rabbi at Temple Emmanuel. He was formerly the president of the New York and New Jersey Board of Rabbis. He is a friend of AEPi and an ally of Israel. Uncle David, thank you very much for joining us to be a part of this. Before we begin, I have a brief question for you. What is your favorite part about Shabbat?
Shabbat is a holiday that comes every week where we are mandated to eat three meals. And that is my favorite part of Shabbat, which is actually hard for me in 24 hours to only eat three meals. I normally have seven, but that is my favorite part of Shabbat.
Noted. Thank you very much, Uncle David. Without further ado, I'd love to pass this over to you to lead us in the D'var. So without going ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, Brother Zach. I can't say brother because I was never a member of a fraternity, but I'm so proud of you, Zachary, as your favorite uncle, to see all the amazing work that you've done and continue to do for AEPi. And you just make us all really proud of you, buddy, every day. So keep up the amazing work. And thank you for giving me this honor of talking to you and all your fellow AEPi brothers around the world. It's a great honor to spend a few minutes before Shabbat with each of you. In shuls across the world tomorrow, we're going to read a parsha that happens to be rich with history and opportunity, Parsha Shelach Lecha. And in it, it tells the famous story of 12 spies that are sent out on a reconnaissance mission to check out Israel, which the Israelites will then be making their way towards. And the idea behind the reconnaissance mission is to say, what's it going to be like when we go to this land? Will we be conquered? Will we conquer it? Will it be easy for us to inhabit? Will it be a land flowing with milk and honey? Or will it have just sand and dust and nothing with opportunity for us? 12 spies are sent, and 10 come back and say, we cannot go here. We're going to be devastated, decimated. We are like grasshoppers compared to the people who live there. We need to find an alternate location. This won't work for us. And two of the spies, Caleb and Yehoshua, had the vision, they had the fortitude, they had the strength to say, no, we can go here and we should go here. Now, what's fascinating about Caleb and Yehoshua and these two optimists, as opposed to the 10 pessimists, is they didn't denounce what the other 10 said, but they had a different perspective. And that perspective was, yeah, we can. We can do this. This can happen. The reason that I bring up this story about the division between the 10 and the 2 is that we're living in a very strange time in the world. We're living in a time where some think that in order for me to be right, you must be wrong. We're living in a time where people think that I can be for Black lives or I can be for Blue lives, which represents the police, but there's no way I can be for both. That if I am inherently part of Black Lives Matter, then I am inherently opposed to Blue Lives Matter and vice versa. And I want to tell you that I believe in my tradition, in my bones, and even from this week's Parsha, that that is wrong. And there are people who want to make that very same declaration when it comes to support for Judaism and Israel. I read an op-ed by someone who I won't quote, who claimed that one can be a liberal Jew and one can be a passionate Zionist, but you can't be both. And then it went on to say that one can support Black Lives Matter and one can support Israel, but one can't do both. And I would say that is two scoops of wrong, just inane, not true. And I would argue that all of us have the place in our lives to hold two truths that might not be totally congruent, but that can live together. And just because some of the people living in the land of Canaan might have been bigger than the Israelite spies doesn't mean that it's not achievable. And it was Caleb and Joshua that realized that. I'm going to talk to you for a minute about some of the sentiments that have been happening over the past weeks in Israel. And this binary dichotomy that's been set up of either or is the wrong paradigm. And I'm going to give you a few examples for me of where and how I can see a place where we can hold two realities and two truths. Here's one. I cry when I see children in Gaza who don't have milk to drink. I'm a father. I am a rabbi. I'm an uncle. I know what it is to see children and to see them who are hungry. And I don't understand any parent who can see a child without milk and not cry for that child. But at the very same time that I cry for that child without milk, I am furious at Hamas for investing their money in a labyrinth of terror tunnels that is meant to bring destruction and terror to its neighbor Israel, and put investments of resources into rockets and rocket launchers and artillery and grenades, as opposed to putting that investment in milk and refrigeration for the children of Gaza. I can feel both of those things without a problem. I can feel heartbroken for young Palestinian children that are used as human shields and played as pawns in this ongoing war with Israel. But I feel an incredible sense of pride that Israel puts a protection around their children, that Israel invests in bomb shelters and in safe rooms, and Israel invests in Iron Dome to keep its citizens safe. So I can feel that pain and be heartbroken for those pawns and those human shields in Gaza, but I also can feel a sense of pride for how Israel looks after its children. I can feel a sense of empathy for innocent Palestinians, teenagers, and even younger than that, who were born into a third generation of conflict that they didn't start and they had nothing to do with. They were born into this conflict with Israel. They didn't ask for it. It's not fair. But at the very same time, I haven't lost sight of the grandparents and great-grandparents of these very same teenagers who had bequeathed to them this fortune that they are inheriting. After all, it was these grandparents and great-grandparents that denied offers of peace with Israel in 1948 and 1967 and 1973 and 1985 and 2000 and 2007 and as recently as 2014. Even today, there is a rejection of much of that peace. So for me, I feel an incredible sense of empathy for people who were born into a conflict that they didn't start. But I also feel a sense of frustration and anger at grandparents who bequeath this inheritance to their grandchildren. To me, this is what it is to hold two truths. We can feel two things at the same time. There was an amazing psychoanalyst by the name of Marsha Linehan. And she developed a form of therapy called DBT, Dialectical Behavioral Therapy. And the basis of that therapy is that we can believe two things and they don't have to exclude each other. I can believe that Black lives matter and I can believe that blue lives matter. I can have empathy for a child that is hungry in Gaza and I can have anger for Hamas that invests its money in terror as opposed to feeding its children. I can feel a sense of frustration for those innocent people who are used as shields in Hamas's warfare, but also feel a sense of incredible pride for how Israel protects its citizens. I can hold these two truths. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai and gave the Israelite people the Torah was written on two tablets. Why not one tablet? Why couldn't all of those rules be written on one tablet? Why'd they have to be written on two tablets? It wasn't a size issue. It wasn't a weight issue. Maybe it was to remind each of us that this notion that's being promoted throughout the world that you can be one or you can be the other, but you can't be both, is wrong. Maybe it is to remind each and every one of us that we can hold two truths at the same time. We can be liberal, and we can be Zionist and supportive of the state of Israel. We can criticize parts of the state of Israel and still have unwavering love for the state of Israel. We can feel a sense of empathy, but also a sense of pride. we are able to say Black Lives Matter and Blue Lives Matter. They're not exclusive of each other. They are inclusive of each other. We can hold two truths at the same time. You can and I can. That didn't come from us. It came from Caleb and Joshua, who had the courage to say, yes, that is a scary land out there. Those people are big people. Us going into that land and conquering that land won't be simple, but it is a land that's flowing with milk and honey. It is also a land with opportunity. And I believe in us. They held two truths. And because of that commitment, that perspective, and that understanding, we're able today to call that land our homeland. There are going to be moments in each of your lives where people are going to put a choice in front of you. Not the choices of what do you want tonight for dinner? Do you want Mexican or do you want Italian? That's not what I'm referring to. What I'm referring to are choices where people are going to say, in order to be one thing, you can't be another. And I would push back on most of those situations like Caleb and Joshua did and say, no, the word and is part of our vocabulary. It's not or. We can be liberal and Zionist. We can be passionate about our views and empathetic at the same time. We can look for ways for us to collaborate and still have lines in the sand. It's not an either or situation in most of life. For those who want to draw us politically and say, if you stand with this character or this candidate, you are out. Don't make room for him or her. Create spaces in your lives, in your work lives, your home lives, your synagogue lives, your personal lives. Make spaces for the word and. Make a place to hold two truths. And in doing so, you're going to keep the tradition of Caleb and Joshua strong. You're going to keep it alive. And you're going to keep that process of what is core to Judaism, part of your hearts and the hearts of everyone who's blessed to be part of your life. I pray that that word and serve as a compass for all of you and that we go from strength to strength. It's a great honor to be with all of you today. I want to wish all of you a Shabbat Shalom, and I send it back to my sweet nephew, Zachary.
Thank you, Uncle David, so much for that wonderful D'var. I especially like, obviously, what you were saying about holding those two truths at the same time and not picking either or. I think that's something that a lot of our brothers are and have food for thought for this coming Shabbat. So thank you very much for that. Thank you again to all of our brothers and friends from across the world tuning in. Be sure to check out our AEPi Connect page and calendar at AEPi.org for future events. Shabbat Shalom and good Shabbos to everyone. Thank you again, Uncle D.
Shabbat Shalom, everyone.